Hello everyone and thanks for watching Edupedia World Videos. I am Manish Agrawal and today we will be starting with the topic of mole concept. So before we start with the topic of mole concept, you need to know how compounds are formed. Alright, so there are certain laws called laws of chemical combination. According to these laws, compounds are always formed by constituting elements in order of some constraints. Okay, so one by one we'll go through those constraints and we'll see what do they mean. Let's start with the first law of chemical combination called law of conservation of mass. As the name suggests, law of conservation of mass says that in a closed container, the amount of mass inside the container will always remain constant. So basically, you take a box, you put something inside it. Let's say you have put one pen, one mobile, you have put 10 grams of rice, and now you close that container and you keep it underground for say 1 century, 2 century. Then you take it out, you take it to the space and you keep it on moon for another 2 centuries, and then you bring it back and now you measure the amount of substance inside the container. The pen might not be pen anymore, the rice might not be rice anymore, maybe it is filled with fungus or some dirt or other stuff. But as long as the container was completely sealed, the total mass inside the container would remain same as the original mass that we put in. So basically, conservation of mass states that as long as we do not open the container, the mass inside a closed container would always remain constant. Why? Because mass can neither be created nor be destroyed. Alright, so this is a very important law as it is valid for any physical and chemical process in the world. It is applicable not only in chemistry but in physics or any other subject that you might want to study. So your input mass will always be equal to your output mass irrespective of the processes which occur in between. Okay, now there is one simple exception to this rule, which is nuclear reactions. Why nuclear reactions are an exception? Because in nuclear reactions, if you will observe, you will study nuclear reactions in detail in your physics and even in chemistry in class 12th. So if you observe nuclear reactions, you will see that in that those reactions, atoms, nucleus like protons and neutrons and other material is often created and even destroyed. But if you look at them closely, you will see that even in those cases, mass is not actually destroyed, it is converted into another form. So even in nuclear reactions, mass is only converted into energy, or the energy is converted back into mass. That's why it seems like mass is being created or destroyed. Alright, so that's why we include nuclear reactions into exceptions of this law. But in reality, even in nuclear reactions, mass is only getting converted into another form. In fact, you already might know the equation through which this change occurs, E equals to mc square, where E is the energy equivalent to mass m. Alright, so now we know what conservation of mass is. Let's move on to the next law of chemical combination, which is law of definite proportion. Okay, it is also called law of constant composition. Why? You will just realize it in a minute. Law of definite proportion says that in a given compound, the weight ratio of constituent element is same. So basically, if you have any compound, let's say you have water, then the mass of hydrogen and oxygen in the water molecule, okay, in one single water molecule is always constant. So when I say I have one water molecule or 1 mole water molecule, it means that I have 2 gram hydrogen and 16 gram oxygen. So basically 1 mole molecule or 18 ग्राम वाटर इज फॉर्म्ड बाय मिक्सिंग 2 ग्राम हाइड्रोजन विद 16 ग्राम ऑक्सीजन. नाउ यू कैन टेक वाटर और यू कैन फॉर्म अ वाटर मॉलिक्यूल हियर इन इंडिया. यू कैन टेक वाटर सैंपल फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान, यू कैन टेक वाटर सैंपल फ्रॉम USA, यू कैन टेक वाटर सैंपल फ्रॉम अफ्रीका. इन एनी ऑफ दिस प्लेस इफ यू मेजर द रेशियो, मास रेशियो ऑफ हाइड्रोजन एंड ऑक्सीजन इन दोज वाटर मॉलिक्यूल्स, यू विल फाइंड इट इज ऑलवेज 2:16 और 1:8. सो इन एनी गिवन कंपाउंड द वेट रेशियो ऑफ कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट एलिमेंट्स इज ऑलवेज सेम और कॉन्स्टेंट. दैट्स वाई इट इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड लॉ ऑफ कॉन्स्टेंट कंपोजिशन. You can see another example, say carbon dioxide, CO2. So CO2 has 12 gram carbon and 32 gram oxygen, let's say. So it means the mass ratio of carbon and oxygen in CO2 is 3:8. So now this CO2 can come from, say, respiration of a human being, or it can be a product of respiration of an animal, or it can be what takes part in respiration of plants, or it can even be from the exhaust of your vehicle. Okay, in any of these cases or in any of the other cases which we have not said about here, the mass ratio of carbon and oxygen will always remain to be 3:8. Okay. So this is what we mean by law of definite proportion. Now here again there is an exception. So there are two exceptions basically. First is isotopes and other is non-stoichiometric compounds. We'll just look at what these exceptions mean. Okay, first isotopes. So hydrogen, you might know hydrogen as two other isotopes. One is deuterium represented by capital D and one is tritium represented by capital T. Alright, so in D2O, now again D2O is nothing but water, but it is actually called heavy water. Okay, so the hydrogen atom in this molecule actually weighs 4 gram. For 1 mole molecules, the hydrogen atom weighs 4 gram, whereas oxygen still weighs 16 gram. So why this change of ratio? Because here we haven't used the actual hydrogen atom, we have used an isotope of hydrogen atom. Similarly, T2O, where T represents tritium, another isotope of hydrogen. Another exception to this rule is non-stoichiometric compounds. Okay, again, this non-stoichiometric compounds is not in our syllabus presently. You will study it in detail in your class 12 solid state topic. Okay, but let's see once again what these exceptions are. So non-stoichiometric compounds are compounds which do not follow whole number ratio of constituent elements. For example, let's say you have iron oxide, FeO. So the iron oxide actually has 1:1 ratio of iron and oxygen atom, FeO. Alright, so if I have, say, a room full of iron oxide molecules, now there are thousands and lakhs of molecules in that room. So there are thousands and lakhs of iron atoms and oxygen atom in the room. Now I can, say, steal 7 atoms of those or 10 atoms of iron out of those thousands and lakhs. So now the ratio of iron and oxygen is no more 1:1. Okay, it is less than 1:1. So such cases result into formation of non-stoichiometric compound. In this case, Fe 0.930. Alright, we don't have to go into calculations of this compound. In 12th standard, you will study how these compounds are actually formed and how do they satisfy other properties of compound like neutrality. Alright, another example can be cupric and cuprous sulfide. Okay, cupric sulfide is not really a common example of non-stoichiometric compound, but cuprous sulfide is often found in non-stoichiometric ratios. In fact, in cuprous sulfide, the ratio varies from 1:7:1 to 2:1. Alright, so non-stoichiometric compound, as you can see, do not follow law of constant composition. And another exception that we studied was isotopes. Again, isotopes we'll study in detail in our next chapter of atomic structure. For now, it is enough for you to know that Isotopes are atoms of an element which have same atomic number but different atomic mass. Okay, so if you remember what atomic number is, you'll realize that having same atomic number results in having similar chemical properties. That's why apart from hydrogen, even deuterium and tritium were able to form water molecules because they had same atomic number but their atomic masses were different. That's why the law of constant composition was not proved in these cases. Alright, for example, carbon also has isotopes carbon 12 and carbon 14. Carbon 12 is what we are used to seeing, but carbon 14 is another isotope of carbon. Okay, similarly, oxygen has isotopes oxygen 16 and oxygen 18. Alright, so if you form compounds using isotope of an element, you might end up seeing that the law of constant composition is not followed. Alright, so now let's move on to the next law in our course. Law of multiple proportion. Alright, now please pay attention over here. More, it's a little bit more difficult. Okay, so law of multiple proportion is used for elements which can combine to form two or more different compounds. For example, hydrogen and oxygen, we know they combine to form water. Okay, that is H2O. What you might not know is that hydrogen and oxygen can also combine to form another compound called hydrogen peroxide, H2O2. Okay, so when two elements can combine to form two or more compounds, they follow law of multiple proportion. Let's see what this law entails. I have water molecule on the left hand side and hydrogen peroxide molecule on the right hand side. Okay, so 1 mole water is formed by 2 grams of hydrogen and 16 grams of oxygen. So here I can see that 16 gram oxygen reacts with 2 gram of hydrogen to form water molecules. Similarly, in hydrogen peroxide, we can calculate that it is formed by 2 gram of hydrogen and 32 gram of oxygen. So in hydrogen peroxide, 32 gram oxygen reacts with 2 gram hydrogen. So if you observe in both the compounds, 2 gram of hydrogen has reacted with different amount of oxygen. Okay, and if I calculate the ratio of these oxygen masses, you will see that mass of oxygen to mass of hydrogen in compound 1 is 16:2, and mass of oxygen and mass of hydrogen ratio in compound 2 is 32:2. Okay, so the law of multiple proportion states that whenever two elements combine to form two or more compounds, the ratio of mass of one element which reacts with fixed mass of another element in the two compounds is a simple whole number ratio. Okay, let's hear it again. The ratio of mass of one element which reacts with fixed mass of another element while forming the two compounds is in simple whole number ratio. So here, if you calculate ratio of mass of oxygen in compound 2 and to the mass of oxygen in compound 1, you will find that that ratio is 32 divided by 16 or 2:1. Okay, so the law of multiple proportion states that the mass of oxygen in compound 1 is to mass of oxygen in compound 2 will be a simple whole number ratio. So these are whole numbers, in fact these are simple whole numbers, and the ratio is a simple whole number ratio, 1:2. Okay. See, these laws, you won't actually directly need them to use in numerical questions or in any of the chapters which we'll come across. But these laws were the basis which resulted in study of chemistry as a science. Okay. In fact, these laws came up at a time when we didn't actually know what atoms and molecules meant. And that gives them a lot of historical significance. because from here we brought about first understanding of what atom might be or how matter might be formed or what molecules are. Okay, so you need to remember these definitions and some examples of each of these definitions. Okay, but you won't actually need to use them anywhere else in the chemistry. Okay, so let's see exceptions to this rule and some more examples. Alright, so first, law of multiple proportion is valid whenever two elements can combine to form more than two compounds. So another example is copper and sulfur. They can combine to form two different kinds of compound. One is cupric sulfide on the left hand side, that is CuS, and other is cuprous sulfide, which is Cu2S. Okay, similarly nitrogen and oxygen can actually combine to form many number of different compounds. Here we have noted two of them, which is N2O nitrous oxide and NO nitric oxide. Okay, so here if you will observe N2O in N2O and NO, nitrogen reacts with fixed mass of oxygen. Okay, in nitrous oxide N2O, 28 gram nitrogen can be said to react with 16 gram of oxygen, whereas in nitric oxide 14 gram nitrogen reacts with 16 gram oxygen. So mass ratio of nitrogen in the two compounds which reacts with a fixed amount of oxygen is 28:14, that is 2:1, again a simple whole number ratio. Similarly in cupric and cuprous sulfide, mass ratio is 1:2. Alright, again a simple whole number ratio. And another point to be noted here is the name nitrous and nitric, cuprous and cupric. Okay, you have already studied this in class 9th while naming the compounds and while studying how compounds are formed. Okay, whenever the valency of the element is lower, we use us, nitrous. Okay, because here nitrogen's valency is lower, whereas here the nitrogen's valency is higher. So here we have used nitric, ic. Alright, similarly if you look at CuS and Cu2S, in Cu2S the valency of copper is lower, it is 1. So the name of this sulfide will be cuprous sulfide, whereas in CuS the valency of copper is 2, that is higher. So the name of this compound will be cupric sulfide. Okay, now the exceptions to this rule, again isotopes will form an exception because in that case cannot be sure of which isotope is taking part in the reaction. Actually even they can follow the law of multiple proportion, but we cannot be sure that what that ratio might be, the ratio in which the compounds react, what that ratio might be. Alright, another exception, now this is definitely an exception, non-stoichiometric compounds. Okay, so non-stoichiometric compounds, as we have already seen, they might not react in whole number ratio. In fact, they do not react in whole number ratios. Okay, the non-stoichiometric compounds, elements in non-stoichiometric compounds do not react in whole number ratios. Okay, so isotopes in law of multiple proportion might not really be an exception. Okay, the isotopes will still have whole number ratios, but we might not be sure what the ratio is unless we know what the isotope taking part in the reaction is. Okay, another exception is polymers. Okay, so polymers, again you have to study later on in inorganic or organic chemistry. Okay, but polymers can also form an exception to a law of multiple proportion, because in polymers there are long chains of molecules, okay, which have combined together and come together to form a long chain compound. So in this cases law of multiple proportion might be violated. So lastly we have Gay-Lussac's law. Okay, Gay-Lussac was the name of the scientist who first came up with this law, who actually experimentally observed this law, and it is actually law of gaseous volume. Okay, it states that when we have a chemical reaction taking place between gaseous reactants. Okay, so let's say I have hydrogen and oxygen, both are gaseous reactants, So the chemical reaction which takes place between gaseous reactants always does so in whole number ratios of volumes of the gaseous reactants. Okay. Let's see it in different words. In a gaseous phase reactions, volume of all gaseous reactants and products are in simple whole number ratio at a given temperature and pressure. Okay. So let's say we take a container. Okay. We take a container and we keep the temperature and pressure for that container constant throughout our experiment. You are not making any variations of temperature and pressure. That is our assumption. Now you measure the volumes of all the components inside the container. Okay. So let's take another example. We have carbon monoxide in the container. It is a gas, right? Reacting with oxygen. Now oxygen is another gas. These two react to form a compound called carbon dioxide. Let's balance this reaction. So here, if you will measure the volume, you will find that two volumes of carbon monoxide always reacts with one volume of oxygen to form two volumes of CO2. When I say volume, it can mean any volume unit. Okay, I can have 2 liters of carbon monoxide. Okay, so in that case I'll have 1 liter of oxygen and I will form 2 liter of CO2, or I can also have 2 milliliter or 2 meter cube of carbon monoxide, 1 meter cube of oxygen and 2 meter cube of CO2 will be formed in that case. Okay, that's why we wrote the term volume. Okay, so the ratio of these gaseous reactants will always be simple whole numbers, 2:1. Okay, in fact even the product is formed in a simple whole number ratio, 2:1:2. Let's take another example. Say I have nitrogen in a container. It again is a gas, reacts with hydrogen, another gas, to form ammonia, a gaseous product. Let's balance this reaction, 2 and 3. Okay. So now here I have N2 plus 3H2 gives 2NH3. So this says that one volume of nitrogen always reacts with 3 volumes of hydrogen. So I need 3 times the hydrogen. Okay, amount of hydrogen is 3 times that of nitrogen, and this forms 2 volumes of ammonia. So the ratio will be 1 liter is to 3 liter is to 2 liter. Okay, a simple whole number ratio. So this is what Gay-Lussac's law states, that in a gaseous phase reaction the reactants are always present in simple whole number ratio, and in fact even the product is formed in a simple whole number ratio of volume, given that temperature and pressure is maintained constant. That is an important condition. You'll understand why in a different chapter. All right. So law called law of equivalent proportion, but it is not directly in the course, so we'll take it up at the end of the mole concept chapter. Okay. And there is another law called Avogadro's law. Now that is a very important law, so we'll devote an entire session to that law, and that is why we'll study it later on in the chapter. Okay. So until next time, and once again thanks for watching Edupedia World videos.